Hey fellas, me Trapper here. Today I'm going to talk about trapping from a kayak. Now, this past season I recently bought a Riverhawk boat and put an outboard motor on it. Very, very happy with it. It's really extended my range, but you know what? I haven't gotten rid of my old kayak. And not only that, I'm still going to use it this coming trapping season. And I'd like to share my thoughts on trapping out of a kayak and some of the tips and tricks that I can share with you and some of my lessons learned. So if you're thinking about going down that road, maybe I can save you a lot of time, a lot of money, and a lot of trouble. First of all, why would you choose a kayak? Let me say the kayak is probably the worst platform for a floating vessel that you can pick to trap from. It has a very limited capacity. They can be fairly tippy. And they're wet, okay? A canoe, on the other hand, is going to give you a lot more capacity. You're going to stay a lot drier in a canoe. And a canoe is also tippy. So if you're looking for big capacity, a canoe is probably a better bet. However, keep in mind that the heavier your vessel gets, the harder it's going to be to paddle, especially when a wind picks up. You get out on open water, and let me tell you something, a kayak sits a lot lower and it has a lot lower profile and it has a lot less wind resistance than a canoe. So once I got my kayak loaded with 300 or 400 pounds of beavers and traps and trapper, it became a real chore to paddle it against a current or against a wind. So keep that in mind. Now the reason I went with a kayak was I wanted to get in to extremely remote places where nobody else could go. I wanted to go places where there may not be a boat ramp, or preferably there is no boat ramp, because the more I can get away with people, the more I can get away from people, rather, the better experience I'm going to have. I'm not going to have theft. I'm not going to have to be looking over my shoulder. I'm not going to have people getting into my business. And so getting into remote backwaters was a key objective of mine. Being able to pick my kayak up with one hand and carry it through the woods or drag it through the woods, push it and shove it and drop it down into the water, pull it back up out of steep banks on creeks and things like that, that was critical. I can't do that with a canoe. I can do that with a kayak. So even though a kayak is a poor platform when it comes to capacity and stability, it was an excellent platform for backcountry access and remote swamp access. So that won out for me. Now, once you start getting into this and you start getting out there and paddling, and you start loading things down, your natural reaction is to try and put a motor on it to try and lessen the labor. And I went through this entire process. And the first thing that most people are going to go to is an electric trolling motor. Works fine. The problem is you got to have a battery, a big, heavy, bulky battery. When you're in a small kayak, you're taking up space that could be better filled up by beavers or traps. Once that battery drains, it's dead weight. And you're having to paddle dead weight. That's no fun. Now on a canoe, you can get a square stern canoe and you can put a bigger motor on it. But once again, you start this cycle where the heavier your boat, the more you need a motor, and the more motor you put on it, the heavier the boat. And you completely get away from the light handheld portability. So what I found is if you're gonna go down this route, you need to make a decision. Are you going to go lightweight and simple, or are you going to go heavyweight and complicated? If you're going to go lightweight and simple, get a kayak, get a good one, get a good paddle, and leave it at that. If you're going to go heavyweight, forget about a kayak, get a canoe, get a square stern canoe, and get a gas motor to put on it. It's that simple. Go one extreme or the other. This middle of the road crap, it doesn't work. It leaves a lot to be desired. So let's take a look at the boat that I use, the features that it has, and what I like and what I dislike, and maybe this will help you in choosing a kayak. Okay, this is the boat that I use. This is a Perception Sport Pescador 12. Now this particular model is a sit-on-top, and that's the two basic types of kayaks. You can have a sit-on-top kayak, or you can have a sit-inside kayak. The sit-on-top has no deck over it. It also has scupper holes all through the hull. So if water comes over and gets into your boat, it's going to drain right out through those holes. The sit-in kayaks that have a deck over them and you slide down in, they're going to stay much drier. The water actually has to get in the cockpit to get in. Now, between the two types of boats, sit-on-top or sit-in, I've had both, I've used both, and my advice is the sit-on-top. The sit-inside kayak is a lot warmer in deep winter when there's an icy wind blowing. That cockpit, you're down inside of it, it really helps keep that wind off of you. But they're a lot harder to get in and out of compared to a sit-on-top. A sit-on-top, you can see, you can just drop down, flop down in there. You can straddle it and sit on. If you flip over, you get out here and you flip over, and you need to re-enter the boat, a sit-on-top, in my opinion, is much easier to get back into. And plus, if you happen to capsize or flip that boat over, with a sit-on-top, all you have to do is right the boat, and the water is all going to drain right back out. If you capsize a sit-in boat and it fills up with water, you're going to have to drag it to the shore. You're going to have to get to the shore, and it's going to have hundreds of pounds of water in it. You're going to have to pull the plug, drain it out. It's a major, major ordeal. Also, I used to do a lot of whitewater kayaking, and you can get trapped in a sit-inside boat, and that's bad news. So when it comes to the type of boat, sit-on-top or sit-in, I vote for a sit-on-top. Okay, so the next decision is which boat. As a general rule, the wider your kayak, the more stable it is, and the slower and harder it is to paddle. The narrower the boat, the faster it is. It's going to be easier to paddle, but it's going to be tippier. Wider is more stable, narrow is more tippy. So you've got to choose. The idea is, for me at least, I'm not trying to win any races out here. I want stability, and I want to be able to carry the boat. So you've got these new Jackson kayaks that are $1,000, $1,500, but they weigh 120 pounds. You can get up and walk around on them. Really nice things, but I can't carry that through the woods. This Perception 12 weighs about 52 pounds, if I remember correctly, about 50 pounds or so. I can easily carry that with one hand. It's like carrying a 5-gallon bucket full of bait or something. It's not stable enough to stand up on, but I'm not fly fishing out of this. I'm trapping out of it. So as far as stability, I only need something that's not super tippy. So that's why I chose the boat that I did. Now the next thing is the length. You can go get a little 10-foot boat, but what's going to happen is when you start paddling that 10-foot boat, it starts doing like that. It doesn't track very well. Tracking means it's going to go in a straight line and keep going in a straight line. That doesn't sound like much until you get out there and you're fully loaded and you start fighting this thing in the wind. You want a boat that's going to go in a straight line that you don't have to constantly paddle this way and that way and this way and that way. And the tracking is dictated by the length of the boat. A real short boat, like a 10-foot long boat, is not going to track very well. A big boat, like a 14-footer, is going to track really well, but it's going to be heavy. So for me, the sweet spot was a 12-foot boat. Now, the next thing as far as cheap versus expensive. The single biggest indicator that I think you need to look at is whether or not a boat is roto-molded or if it's a clamshell boat. All of your cheaper kayaks, you go to Walmart, you go to Academy Sports, and you look at the $200, $350 boats, they're all clamshell boats. And what that means is the top was one piece of plastic, the bottom was another piece of plastic, and they clamped them together, and then they sort of plastic welded the two halves of the clamshell together. On those boats, if you go midway down, right about, let's see if you can see, right about in here, where the top and the bottom would meet, there's going to be a seam, a distinct seam. What'll happen is over time, The top of the boat is exposed to the sun and it's going to get hot. The bottom of the boat is in the water and it's going to stay cool. So you're going to have two pieces of plastic. One's going to heat up and expand. One's going to cool down and contract, and you're going to get leaks. The clamshell boats are going to leak sooner or later. They're going to weep, seep, whatever you want to call it, but you're going to end up at the end of your trip or at the end of your paddle with water inside there. So what? That makes it heavier, makes it harder to paddle, makes it harder to load, unload, and it's a pain in the butt. This particular Perception, this is a roto-molded boat. You can see there's no welding seam right there. Hopefully you can see, but that's smooth. And that's because this boat was molded and not clamped together. So when it comes to looking at a kayak, if you look at two boats, one of them's 12 feet, the other one's 12 feet, they have similar features or whatever, and one's $200 or $250 more than the other, look at that clamshell design. And in my opinion, I will not have a clamshell boat. Not going to have one. Okay, the next thing to look at is hatches. Hatches and cargo space. This is the forward hatch right here on this Perception. And you can open this up and you can see it's got a nice big hatch. You can really cram a lot of stuff down in there. When I'm traveling, I take the paddle apart into two pieces, stick it up under there, take my life jacket, cram it up in there, take my tackle box or little bitty fishing pole that I take just for fun. I can stow a lot of that stuff up in there. That keeps it out of the way, keeps it from blowing off, what have you. These boats also have these little hatches. These are completely, totally useless. I consider this more of a service entrance, so that if I need to do something like when I put this little electric motor mount back here, I was able to stick my hand in there and get to the bottom and work on it. This is really, in my opinion, useless for storing cargo. I mean, yeah, you might be able to take a real small dry bag or something and shove it down in there, but you're not going to get much more than a raincoat or something down through that hole. You're definitely not going to get any traps, and even your snares you'd have to squanch up and put down in there. So this is more of a service entrance. You got to think about stuff like that, because you may want to add another rod holder. If you want to add another rod holder, that's going to be a great place to get your hand under there and put more rigging on your boat. I really, really like the open back. You can go through my videos. That's where I stack beavers up. That'll hold 330s. Put a beaver on top of it, another beaver on top of it. Put the rigging on, and you're done. You can also cram a beaver down in through the front hatch, but you're only going to get one in there. If it were up to me, I would take this open cargo area on the front and the back, and I would do away with that. The problem is that the manufacturers, they have to keep adding new features every year to make everything bigger, better, faster, shinier, and more expensive. And what I've noticed, if you go to the store, if you go to, you know, Field & Stream, Bass Pro, or whatever, and start looking at all the new offerings, they got fancier and fancier and fancier hatches. They have hatches that lock, hatches that look cool, tough guy He-Man hatches. I'd rather do without any hatches and just have flat cargo space, because you're going to be piling stuff up on here. You're going to be piling critters up. And these hatches, they might be great for camping. They might be great for keeping your gear dry when it rains or what have you. But we all know if you're going to be out in the swamp and you're going to be trapping beavers, you're going to be wet. So that is, you know, simple as that. So when it comes to hatches and features and rigging, once again, my advice is to keep it simple. The more flat, open area that you have to where you can choose to stack what you want, how you want, the better. The more hatches and the more sophisticated the hatches, the more they're forcing you to accommodate your gear to their openings and their designs. And it just doesn't seem to work for me. One thing that I do use on the back, and you can see in a lot of my videos, is a milk crate. If you have some small items, like if you're stacking snares up or anything like that, you can put a milk crate in there to keep everything organized, to keep little items from going around. Speaking of that, let's talk about how we organize our boat and how we keep stuff above the water and off the bottom of the river. Rule number one, you're going to flip your boat. At some point, somehow, some way, if you don't flip it completely over, you're going to dump. It's going to happen. If you don't want your expensive traps and your expensive gear on the bottom of that stuff out there in the dead of winter, you got to tie it down. One thing you'll notice is that on every one of these little islets, just about, I've got a piece of paracord. Notice how I like yellow, bright colors. My float rope up there, yellow. My bag, D-ring on it, and it's attached to this cord right here. Now I have this bag unzipped because I was in here getting stuff out, but when I'm underway, that bag is zipped up and it is attached to this boat. If I dump this boat, or if it gets tippy, I hit a stump, something bad happens and I go up, even if that bag goes over into the water, nothing's going to spill out of it because it's zipped up, and the bag is not going to go anywhere because it's tied to the boat. You want everything you can possibly get tied to the boat. Just trust me on that. Make sure that you have everything either securely stored down inside or dummy corded to the boat. I can't stress that enough. When it comes to your traps, this rigging is really good. If you flip your boat completely, it's not going to keep your traps in. They're going to go because they're heavy and that's elastic cord. But if you just get tippy, or you dump a little bit to one side or the other, that right there will keep all your Belial 330s from ending up out in the middle of that. Now when you pull up to the bank, you get out to make a set, you want to make sure your kayak doesn't float off down the river. So you have to anchor your boat. Now remember, we're not fishing. We're not anchored out in the water. We're anchored up here on the bank where it looks like the pigs have been going and getting into my tripod. But yeah, they've been all up in here. But we want to make sure that when we pull up to the bank, we get out, that our boat doesn't float off while we're busy making our set. Not that that's ever happened to me. This right here is something that I made. I just took a little piece of 3/8 inch rebar, took some number 9 trapping wire, and I welded a loop of number 9 wire on the piece of rebar, and then put a bowline hitch on it. And you can see I've got probably 4 or 5 feet of line here, and I've tied it to the boat. I don't want my boat drifting way out in the current, because my boat is my floating supply house. That's where my traps, my lures, my pliers, my tools, everything else is. All this does, that simply sticks down in there, and it takes a lot of force to pull that out. Very easy to pull out, toss it back in, and away you go. That right there is one of the best tips I can give you. It was free, didn't cost me anything, and I use it at every stop, I can promise you. I like a good floating line so that I can see where my line is. I don't want anything sinking. I like a good bright color. I replace my line every year. Doesn't do you any good to have a good anchor if your line's dry rotted and it cracks and pops and off your boat goes. So that's how I anchor my boat. Now let's talk about getting in and out of your boat in freezing ice cold water without dying. Now when you see a place that is going to make a good set, the natural tendency is for most people to paddle perpendicular to the bank, beach the boat, and to get out. One little problem with that. There's a lot of places where the water there is 6 inches deep and the water there is 10 feet deep. If you try to get out right there, you don't know how deep that water is. Also, the water over there may be 3 feet deep, and that may be a 12-foot hole. That's where your dipstick comes in handy. You stick that in, and if it goes down too deep, you know the water is too deep to get in and out of. Seems like common sense, but you can go along, let's say make a set, everything is a foot deep, and then boom, you're in trouble. A better idea, and one that I get in the habit of, is I don't pull in perpendicular to the bank. I pull in parallel. So I want the boat parallel to the bank, and then I want to exit on the bank side. That right there is a much better way to approach the bank. And I would exit onto that side after measuring the depth of the water, because a lot of the places where I'm at, that right there is 2 feet deep. That right there is 10 feet deep. Very important that you know what you're getting into, and don't just measure one area. Stick it all around. Get a feel. Stick it on this side. Get a feel for what that bank is doing. Is that bank doing that, or is that bank doing that? Make sure you know your area before you get out, because if you get out and go in over your head, your day just got real bad. So that's the best way to approach. The problem is a lot of times you'll have brush sticking out, and it makes it very difficult to do that. If I can't approach safely and get an exit and entry back into the boat safe, I pass the set. No beaver is worth going swimming for in ice cold water. The final thing about safety is one of these, a life jacket. You can go through every video, 200 something videos on my channel, you're not gonna see me on the water without one of these. Period, end of story. This will save your life, and trapping is not worth dying for. When you get out in ice cold water, what I'm gonna be wearing is I'm gonna be wearing neoprene waders, chest waders, with the big heavy rubber boots, and I'm gonna have this, and then warm clothing. When you hit that water, if you take a step off into a hole or something happens, you hit a stump and you flip, when you hit that ice water, people, it hurts. It is debilitating. It's shocking. It takes your breath away. I don't care how good of a swimmer you are. I don't care how tough you are. It hurts. And it instantly induces panic. And wear a life jacket, okay? Just do yourself a favor. Do your friends and family a favor. And get you a decent life jacket and wear it. The idea is to have fun and to further our survival, and you can't do that if you're dead. So keep that in mind. As far as waders, I like neoprene waders. Neoprene has a slight positive buoyancy. A lot of people are under the idea that if you get over your waist in waders, it's going to suck you to the bottom. That's not true. Wear good quality neoprene waders, and I have violated that in the past because it's so hot down here, but that's something that I'm going back to is neoprene waders. Put a belt on them, and then make sure you have a good life jacket. Now, when it comes to the life jacket itself, I like ones that have pockets on them, and I keep a few supplies in here, and I think I'm going to surprise some people with how little I keep in here, but let me show you what I keep. And let me explain why, and why I don't have a lot of other stuff in it. All right, here's my survival kit that I keep in my pocket of my life jacket. Now, I've untied this from my life jacket, but this stays tied to my life jacket. The paracord is, of course, orange paracord. Very simple, three things. A compass. If I have to walk out or walk to a point, I gotta know what direction is what. Water, I can get this wet, I can go swimming with this, doesn't hurt it. Signal mirror, good quality signal mirror right here. Let's see, there we go. Very important. Storm whistle, very, very important. Why don't I have fire starting stuff? Why don't I have flashlights? Why don't I have all of that? Remember, this stays in the pocket of my life jacket 24/7, 365 days a year. With something like a flashlight, I'm going to have to worry about checking batteries. I'm going to need a compass. I know I'm going to need a compass just to know which way is up, which way is down. If I'm flipped over and disoriented, and I don't know which way is I need to go to try and get home or to get back to the main water to get help, I got to have a compass. This right here, I'm not out at nighttime, okay? I'm out during the daytime. This thing right here works great. Nice signal mirror. Anybody that when you're out on these waters, when you get out on big open water, this can be seen a long, long, long way away, and it will attract attention out on the water. This whistle is a storm whistle. It's extremely loud. You may not be able to attract somebody's attention by waving. If somebody is 800, 900 yards away across the water, and you're bobbing up and down in the water, you're out there splashing around in the water, they may not see your arm. They will hear this. This is loud. Remember, people are going to have outboard motors running. Signal, direction. And of course, it stays tied to me. There are no batteries to go bad, nothing to get wet. Moisture won't affect any of this. You can see the focus on these three items is not survival long term. It's to get noticed by somebody else. That's my thinking on this. This stays in my pocket and it stays tied to me at all times. So hopefully this has been helpful. If you're thinking about trapping out of a kayak, or you're thinking about going into water trapping and not sure if you need to go full-blown John boat with an outboard motor, or do you want a canoe, or do you want a kayak, hopefully this has given you something to think about. And if you go back and look at a lot of my other videos, you'll see that I use snares a lot, and I think you can see why now. I can take a lot of snares, put them in a 5-gallon bucket, stick them down in the front hatch of my boat, and go trap beavers. And that doesn't take up very much weight. If I tried to carry a dozen 330s, that would be difficult. So anyway, if you have any questions, let me know. And thanks for watching.